Good evening, and welcome to worship. Well, first I want to say I did have a great vacation, and we had a very nice time away with some wonderful weather down at the beach. Much better than what we are experiencing this evening. And thank you, Ted, for leading worship on Sunday. I really appreciate it. A reminder that About the Highway is this Saturday morning. There is a sign-up sheet, but you can talk to Brenda as well. I'm sure she's happy to take volunteers. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship with the prelude. Please rise as you are able. Jesus Christ is the light of the world.
The light of the world is never gone.
Stay with us, Lord, for it is evening.
And the day is almost true.
Let your light scatter the darkness.
And illuminate the church.
Behold, now is the acceptable time. Turn us again, O God of salvation.
That the light of your face may shine on us.
May your justice shine like the sun.
And may the poor be lifted up.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning you called light into being. And you set lights in the sky to govern night and day. And a pillar of cloud by day, and a pillar of fire by night, you led your people into freedom. Enlighten our darkness by the light of your Christ. May your word be a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. For you are merciful, and you love your whole creation. And with all your creatures we give you glory. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord God, you breathe new life into your people. Remind us that you keep your promises and that your love stays with us even through death. Thank you for your forgiveness found in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. Our reading comes from Ezekiel chapter 37, beginning at the first verse. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. There were very many lying in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, "Mortal, can these bones live?" I answered, "O Lord God, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord.' Thus says the Lord God to these bones, 'I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you. And you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord.' And so I prophesied as I had been commanded. And as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them. But there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, 'Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, Thus says the Lord God, Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live.' I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived, and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, 'Mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say our bones are dried up, and our help is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore prophesy and say to them, Thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord, when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people. I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live. And I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord." The word of the Lord. Let us read responsively Psalm 143. Lord, hear my prayer, and in your faithfulness heed my supplications. Answer me in your righteousness. For my enemy has sought my life, and has crushed me to the ground, making me live in dark places like those who are long dead. I remember the time past. I ponder all your deeds. I consider the works of your hands.
I spread out my hands to you. My soul rests to you like
a O Lord, make haste to answer me. My spirit fails me. Do not hide your face from me, or I shall be like those who go down to the pit. Deliver me from my enemies, O Lord, for I flee to you for refuge.
Deliver me from
Revive me, O Lord, for your name's sake, for your righteousness' sake. Bring me out of trouble. Grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. War scars the mind as much as the body. Horrifying images are burned into our collective memory. Civil War artist Alfred Watt, a journalist for Harper's Weekly, sketched soldiers clearing a battlefield of the corpses of their comrades. The smoke billowing in the background marks the pile of equine corpses that had to be burned. Assyrian artists carved battle scenes into massive stone reliefs where the severed heads signified their power over their enemies. And just this week, soccer star David Beckham gave a doctor in Ukraine access to his Instagram in order to highlight the amazing work of those in the medical field. Beckham allowed Dr. Irina, who cares for pregnant women and babies, is the head of a perinatal center in Kharkiv, to take over his Instagram. And this gives her the opportunity to show his 71.6 million followers the conditions medical professionals are currently working in Ukraine. The book of Ezekiel is showing us a similar scene. The book centers on the oracles of a former priest of Jerusalem who has been exiled to Babylon. His oracles, which are dated, span the years leading up to and immediately following Babylon's utter destruction of Ezekiel's former city. And the language of the book bears the scars of a collective trauma. For Ezekiel's original audience, the description of a field strewn with dry bones would have immediately called to their mind images of a battlefield. When an army was defeated, the victor would often leave most of the corpses unburied, stripping the bodies of any valuables that they might have had, while leaving the flesh out in the open for birds of prey and other predators to pick from. And so this chilling vision of a valley of dry bones doesn't mention the equally unnerving depiction of those disarticulated bones coming together, bone by bone, then sinew by sinew, then covered by flesh and covered by skin, but still somehow dead, as if this was then a valley full of zombies. And so if there is new life and resurrection, then it will only come after disjointed, dissected, even ghastly death. To put it in view of the Passion, there is no daybreak on Easter morning without the cruel, grim, violently bloody Friday. And so this scene takes place while Ezekiel is under the Lord's power and while he was in the Lord's Spirit. And so it clearly is a prophetic vision, a visual metaphor. And the valley where this vision takes place is eerie enough since it's full of bones. But things get even more spine-tingling when God leads him through and around all of these bones. Not only are there thousands of bones for Ezekiel to wade through, they are said to be very dry. These bodies have been dead for a long time, and therefore all that is left of them is these bones, and they're also brittle. They've been exposed to the elements, and God only knows how long they've been there. So after this grisly tour of all of this death, God asks Ezekiel a straightforward question. Can these bones live? Now, of course, all evidence is to the contrary. Those bones, dead for so long, so dry, so brittle. But Ezekiel responds to the question with an answer that also doesn't really answer the question. You may know the answer to that, Lord, but I definitely don't, he says. Now, it's very hard to know Ezekiel's tone here. What is certain is that he doesn't jump to some overly confident answer. He doesn't say yes to God's question. And so once again, there's a whole lot of these dry bones that everywhere you look. But the prophet Ezekiel doesn't deny God's ability either and say no. But instead says, God, only you know what can happen next. So if this is some sort of test, we don't know if Ezekiel has passed. And it doesn't seem to matter to God, because God doesn't respond to Ezekiel's answer, but instead commands him to prophesy to the bones, ordering them to listen to the word of God. And Ezekiel does what he's told. The work isn't done after the first sermon to the bones, though. They are now collected, like the song, Them Bones, Them Bones, Them Bones. That's where this comes from, this passage in Ezekiel. But they remain zombie-like, a great host of body with no breath, and therefore no life. So God tells Ezekiel to prophesy a second time, this time to breath itself, that it come from the four winds and bring life to these dead bodies. And this second sermon does the trick. The breath comes and the bodies come to life, stand up as an exceedingly large and impressive force. The Hebrew actually repeats the word to talk about how large it was. But then comes a third sermon. This one is God preaching. Preaching to the prophet, preaching to the exiles who are hearing from the prophet, and preaching to us using this elaborate visual metaphor of these bones. God says that these bones are the house of Israel, the exiles themselves, according to the Lord. They have been saying that their bones are all dried up. And God has taken and literalized their figure of speech in the vision of these dry bones, and gives it back to the exiles in reply. God knows the exiles feel cut off. God knows they're using figures of speech and talking about how their hope is gone and that they are completely cut off from God. And things were bad for the exiles, but obviously it was worse for these dry bones. And God has made it better for the bones, and so maybe God will make it better for the exiles. If the bone part of what the exiles said isn't true, then maybe the part about their hope being gone or them being caught off isn't quite true either. And yet God doesn't rebuke the exiles in the least. Instead, the Lord affirms repeatedly that the exiles are indeed in graves, but graves that God will open up in order to raise them up and return them back to their homeland. And so now God is the one who is speaking figuratively. He knows that they aren't actually dead. Ezekiel's audience is a live one, and they are a completely devastated one as well. And their deaths, their graves, their dashed hopes and feeling of being finished are the complicated result of human disobedience mixed with divine judgment. And it is God's breath. Since God promises to put God's own breath on the exiles, to the same effect in the bodies of the valley, tells them, you will live. And God immediately shifts metaphors, playing instead a divine gardener who plants Israel back in its own homeland. And the goal of all this activity is once again that Israel will know that I am the Lord, that they are no longer cut off from God. And a threefold promise is made. I've spoken, and I will do it. This is what the Lord says. Surely God's promises shown in the vision of the dry bones are designed to address the very real and comprehensive devastation that the exiles felt so far from home and so far from God's goodwill. But that distance is now overcome definitively and downright miraculously by the God who plants, who opens up graves for people long dead, who has resurrection power, and whose very breath enlivens. God's words God's promises and God's vision brought hope to those who felt like they were so far gone that no one and nothing could reach them. Not even death could stop God from bringing life to God's people. From the very dust of the bones, God restored the people of Israel, and God will restore us too. And we may feel cut off from God, disconnected from God, or full of despair for our present situation or the situation of the world. But we have a God of restoration who has taken death and into it has breathed life. Our restoration began in the person Jesus Christ, the one who endured death on the cross so that God could breathe new life into us. And God has taken our dry bones and given us new life, a new life that continues even beyond death. Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world,
Lord,
for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the health of the creation, for abundant harvest that all may share, for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For public servants, the government, and those who protect us, for those who work to bring peace, justice, healing, and protection in this and every place, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who travel, for those who are sick and suffering, and for those who are in captivity, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For deliverance in the time of affliction, wrath, danger, and need, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all servants of the church, for this assembly, and for all people who await from the Lord great and abundant mercy, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Giving thanks for all who have gone before us and are at rest, rejoicing in the communion of all the saints, we commend ourselves, one another, and our whole life to you, through Christ our Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O God, from whom have come all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works, give to us, your servants, that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey your commandments, and also that we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may live in peace and quietness. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, God forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to boldly pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. serve the Lord.